All right, good morning and welcome to this regularly scheduled meeting of the East Kelowna Transcona Community Committee this Wednesday, April 28th, 2021. I am Jason Schreier, this year's chair of the East Kelowna Transcona Community. I'm the city councilor for the Elmwood East Kelowna Ward. We have with us as well Sean Nason, city councilor for the Transcona Ward, as well as Jeff Brawati, city councilor for the North Kelowna Ward. We recognize that we are on Treaty 1 territory and the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. At this time, Clerk Pomanski, we have Tamara Pomanski, our committee clerk, with us as well. We've got Femi Ojo, the senior planner from Planning Property and Development, with us here today for the East Kelowna Transcona Community Committee. And what am I missing, Clerk Pomanski, at this time?
We can proceed to the motions for the minutes and the residents advisory, and then if anyone has announcements.
Okay, Councillor Nason, would you move the minutes of the previous meeting?
So moved.
Those in favor?
Aye.
All right, so motion's carried. And Councillor Brawati, would you move the minutes of the resident advisory group for the East Kelowna Transcona Community Committee?
So moved.
Those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries.
Councillor Nason mentioned he had an announcement.
Yes, Councillor Nason, please.
I do, and it's a brief one, but nonetheless important. Annually on April 28th is National Day of Mourning for employees that have been killed or injured in the workplace and have resulting from their work. And I know over the last year we've lost the members of the Winnipeg Police Service. There's been other staff members that have been lost over time from transit and from public works. There is a need to recognize these losses and work to ensure that, if possible, to identify challenges and assist our workers as much as possible. Mental health through COVID-19 is presenting itself as a real challenge, and it's a challenge that we're going to have to deal with long after the pandemic hopefully will be in our rearview mirror soon. But mental health challenges are a challenge in our workplace, and if you or anyone you know is needing help, reach out. 211 is available to connect the services, and I ask that you do try to reach out. Thank you.
Councillor Nason, maybe we should stand and have a moment of silence to think of those in the past.
That was a great suggestion. We'll rise in the chamber for a moment of silence.
Thank you, Councillor Nason. Councillor Brawati. Clerk Pomanski.
We'll move to delegation. We have one delegation with us today registered. We have Ingrid Molman from River East Transcona School Division to be heard with respect to Community Incentive Grant, River East Transcona School Division, report number 3.
Good morning, Ingrid. Are you there?
She's joining us right now.
Good morning, Ingrid. Good morning. Please state your name and address, and you've got 10 minutes.
Right. Okay. My name is Ingrid Molman. My address is 906 Fleet Avenue, and I'm the languages consultant for River East Transcona School Division. I've made a request for $10,000 from the City of Winnipeg for a multilingual sidewalk poetry project involving 11 schools and all 5 second language programs that we offer in River East Transcona. We would be looking at having students paint original poetry on sidewalks in the city of Winnipeg. in an fairly unobtrusive way. They would be in strips of 24 inches by 8 inches along one side of the sidewalk. And the idea is really to get students to do something creative with their second language, to get them outside, because it's been a very difficult year in COVID, as you know, to celebrate all the languages we teach in River East Transcona, to model some inquiry style learning in the school division. So we have a real public that really motivates kids to produce things well, and obviously to play with language and get into some very interesting short forms of poetry that come from a variety of traditions. I guess the other thing I could say is the way we plan on doing this was modeled after something that happened at in St. Boniface out of La Maison Gabrielle-Roy. A couple of years ago, they had some poetry go onto the sidewalks of St. Boniface to celebrate Gabrielle-Roy, and it was a path all the way through St. Boniface. And it was such a neat idea. I thought, boy, we could do that. And it will get the kids outside, because it's sort of one of the only ways left to us to be super creative in this very difficult time. And it will beautify the neighborhood as well. So we're hoping that this will be viewed favorably. I do have about 1,250 kids interested in participating. And as I say, there are 11 schools across 3 wards in River East Transcona. So that would be Transcona, Elmwood East, and River East, all of those, not all of the schools, but 11 of them in all 3 wards. And I guess the other thing you should know is that the way this is done is that students would produce their poetry, and then when we've worked with them to edit, et cetera, then what would happen is we get that poetry written into plexiglass. So there are plexiglass stencils that are then spray painted. So it doesn't look like a big mess on the sidewalk. There's not going to be anybody free painting or any of that kind of thing. It's going to be quite a neat job. I don't know if there's anything else you might want to ask.
Any questions from my fellow counselors?
Yep.
Was that Councillor Nason?
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
I'm the one without hair in the chamber.
In the chamber, okay.
There we go. Have you talked to the Winnipeg Public Service about the ability to do this?
Yes, I have. And I've also sent a photo of what was done in St. Boniface. And they feel that if I put it on one side of the sidewalk and we take these 24 inch by 8 inch strips, that will not be a problem with the city of Winnipeg. So I've identified areas in my application around each school. These things will be community projects. The Transcona Trail and the Gateway Trail would be involved, and also sidewalks around the schools. Some of the sidewalks would be on school property, so that's less complicated, but the city does feel that this would pass inspection.
So in Transcona specifically, why the Transcona Trail? Because it is nowhere close to Coal Region Park.
Because they were given a piece of the trail to look after. So that's why they picked that particular place, if that's okay with you and the city, obviously.
So that's asphalt versus concrete.
Yeah.
So the other locations would be on concrete.
Right. The school that has picked the Gateway Trail is Sun Valley School, which is very close. And so the only one I think that Regent Park that had picked the Transcona Trail because they're looking after a piece of that trail.
Okay. So what if, look, we've had this done, without permission in Transcona as a project. And it was an afterthought, so I appreciate you coming before it was done. What about maintaining and removal?
It will gradually just wear off. It doesn't have to be maintained. I mean, it depends if the neighborhood wants it maintained, then we could look at respraying. It lasts a couple of years and then it's history. Mm-hmm. So it's not a permanent thing. Paint does wear off, as you know, but apparently in St. Boniface, you can still see the poetry a couple of years later. So they've tried it before. We know what happens. And they painted in St. Boniface, they did a white background, and they suggested we didn't do that, that we not do that. The reason being that the white paint in the background, I mean, it did make the words stand out more, but it did chip away very fast and wash away in the rain. What didn't wash away was the poetry. And so we're just going to go with poetry.
Thank you, Councillor Nason. I'm trying to go over the costs here, and I really do appreciate the idea. It just seems, when it comes to the financial request, is it $20,000?
My request, the cost is $20,000. My request is for $10,000. It's because I have 1,250 kids participating. So for me to put these into plexiglass stencils and buy the paint for that number of kids, I worked out the math, and in my application, that's all outlined. It said $12.95 a stencil, and then we have paint costs as well.
Yes.
So I would cover half of the $10,000. I would cover $10,000 from my budget in the school division. And if we want every kid to be able to paint, then we'd need another $10,000. We would, of course, take whatever it is you give us, you know, and then we'll have to scale down as a function of what it is that we get. So.
And when you say that, aside from the request from the community committee councillors,
yeah.
That you'll be putting in 10,000, or you'll be doing it matching?
I will be putting in 10,000.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I do have a supplementary question.
Sure.
Going through the documents that are here.
Yes.
I didn't see any, I don't currently see any correspondence from, the superintendent of schools or that committing and confirming the other 10,000?
It's my own budget, because I am a consultant. I have a languages budget. And because there are five language programs participating, I can take money from each of those budget sub-budget lines. And I sign off on those things.
Okay. So you're the authorized party on
that. That's right. Yeah.
Okay. Just, you know, with the fact that we have an audited financial statement as part of it.
Right. Well, I work for the school division, right? So for me to give you audited statements, I have to give you the whole school division.
Okay.
My own budget is a tiny fraction of that money, but I would easily, all the superintendents are aware that I'm going ahead with this project. So if you need a supplementary letter, I could certainly provide that.
Thank you.
Thank you. And the one that had been done in St. Boniface, what was the cost of that one?
I was actually grateful to the city for insisting on checking for two costings, because they went with an organization I started with, and their cost was so much higher for the stencils. It was quite staggering. It would have been a $50,000 project with them. But they only did a limited number. I believe they had 30 poems or 35 poems or something. So it was, you know, a much more expensive per poem because of the differential. I can get that for you if you like. In the costing that I got, I found another company that was going to do it much more cheaply. But what they did it for, just let me get on the glasses here, is... that's the Artist Emporium, so we got to go up here. Yeah, Acryl Design, I've got doing it for $12.95. It was Contempora Signs, and their price was $45 each, $35 if I had a big order. So it was a huge differential in cost, so much more expensive per poem.
All right. Thank you, Ingrid Mullman. Any thank further questions for Ingrid? So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right.
Chair, Chair, that concludes our delegation, so we can move to reports.
All right, we are in reports. Item number one, per capita grant, Ecole Springfield Heights School PAC.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. This is in the North Caledonian Ward. Although the parent teacher or the parent I'm working with actually lives in the Transcona Ward. Regardless, I will move the $1,800 from the North Caledonian allocation, please.
Okay. Motion's been heard. Those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Item two, Land Dedication Reserve, Sun Valley Park, Parent Advisory Council, Sun Valley Park Improvement Project.
This is very exciting. This is part of a multi-piece, multi-year project that the Parent Council at Sun Valley School, in conjunction with our park staff, have come together to work on. Sun Valley School is an interesting case. There's a lot of cases in the area where we have city community clubs, even like over at Springfield Heights, for example. Much of North Caledonian Community Club is on school division property. In this case, it's almost the exact opposite, where the school is on a little postage stamp of land, and most of the playground at the school is, in fact, City of Winnipeg Park. It's an interesting combination, but regardless, there's been a lot of fundraisers, lots of events that have led to this point where the school is ready to do this this current part of the their works. So I would like to move, where is the amount? $70,000 from the North Caledonian Land Dedication Reserve to this project in Sun Valley School.
Okay, those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. Clerk Pramansky, we've now done our report items. At this time, are we allowed to go into hearings, or if there's any?
We have still another report, number three, and I think we have some new business on its way as well.
Pardon me?
I have still a report three, the community incentive grant for the River East Transcona School Division. And then I believe some new business will be coming as well.
Some new business, which we could do now. Okay, that's great. Excuse me, report item number three, community incentive grant, River East Transcona School Division.
Mr. Chair, if the clerk could resend the balance for the community incentive grant, just so we're all on the same page today.
Yes.
I'll do that right away. Just a second, please.
Yeah, my search and email is not.
I'm not finding them recently.
That's great.
There we go.
All right. You're gonna have to give me a moment. Okay. I'm good. How about the rest of us? Councillor Nason?
I'm good as well.
Mr. Okay. Chair?
Councillor Roy?
I did reflect on the comments made by the Residents Advisory Group in terms of some concern about continuing to support school division activities? What role should the city be playing versus what role should the education system be playing in these types of programs? Definitely appreciate their feedback on those comments. But that said, I am prepared to support this particular project at this time. Request is for a total of $10,000. There's 14 sites that are proposed in this, 7 in the North Caledonian Ward, 5 in the East Caledonian Elmwood Ward, and 2 in the Transcona Ward. It works out about $714.29 per location. If you guys are interested in participating, I was going to put up half of the $5,000, and that would leave $3,571.45 for Jason and $1,428.58 from Transcona, if you guys are amenable.
How much would it be for mine, Jeff?
$3,571.45 is what I worked out.
$3,571.45. Okay. And what's Transcona?
$1,428.58.
Okay. Now, all right, we're getting to something. Bear in mind, of my ward, only not even 60% of my ward is in the River East Transcona School Division. Bear that in mind. So I'm not one third in the school division. And based on placement of the schools, I see where you're coming from, Councilor Berwadi. I'm thinking also in terms of catchment. And I simply don't represent as much of the school division as the rest of my fellow councillors. And I'm wondering if we put that into the matrix as well as we weigh this. I certainly do appreciate that you are looking at this form of equitability. And I'm wondering if we could do this another way. Were I to do 3,000, and Transcona do 2,000, Transcona is still giving less, but Transcona is fully in the school division, and my ward's not.
I had 2,000 wrote on my page.
You did.
Okay,
that's great. All right.
North Caledonian, $3,000, East Caledonian, $2,000, Transcona. That's my motion. We support this with that breakdown from the CIGP allocations.
All right. Great motion. Those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Motion carries. Thank you, councillors. All right.
Move suspension of the rules for new business.
Fair enough. Councillor Nason?
Okay. Yeah, are we voting on that?
Call the question. Excuse me.
Yeah, those in favor, aye. Motion carries, and please continue, Councilor Mason.
I don't know if the clerk has circulated by email. I do have an item of new business that the clerk is in the process of circulating. It was a last minute crafting of it, and I apologize.
No, it's all good.
I do have a copy here.
I know you've got a physical copy, but the chair does not, so. Okay. The guy who's closest is farthest away. Madam Clerk. Okay. Yep. Mr. Chair, have you received it?
I'm. Give me a moment, please. I have to take a gander at this properly.
very stoic look.
That's fine with me, Councillor Neeson. That's consistent with everything I've done, including getting the support of council to include the word voluntary before, lest Winnipeggers think it wasn't voluntary and it was a real true.
Can I introduce the item?
Yes. Pardon me?
Can I introduce the item?
I'm sorry, Councillor Neeson.
Can I introduce the item?
Oh, by all means.
Okay. So the item of new business that I'm presenting today is with regards to the lobbyist registry. At present, since 2017, the registry that the city of Winnipeg has put in place has been voluntary, that within 10 days of lobbying activity of those that would be deemed lobbyists are requested to register their lobbying efforts of the public service and or elected officials. Through some conversations that occurred at council in recent months with regards to openness and transparency and ways things that council can do things better, reflected on that and thought that you know, this might be a good idea to go from being a optional practice to a mandatory practice. Through conversations, brief conversations that it be with the integrity commissioner at the city of Winnipeg, who has part of the responsibility for oversight on this. A lot of the work does fall to the city clerks to make sure that things are in there as they should be. There was conversations that indicated that there are Canadian municipalities that have lobbyist registries that are mandatory. It's not unexpected that there will be an additional cost to this openness and transparency. I fully expect it. But as part of this report, it's to have that look at what other Canadian municipalities are doing in regards to that, the costing, staffing that may be involved, along with what bylaws at the city of Winnipeg and or the provincial level under the Winnipeg Charter that may be required to take such a change. That is my motion. I welcome questions or comments.
Thank you, Councillor Neeson. Any comments or questions for Councillor Neeson? Councillor Broady?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I'm just running through Demas here really quick. I can confirm that back when the original lobbyist registry was contemplated by council, we did ask our public service to prepare the specific amendments that could be forwarded to the province for a mandatory lobbyist registry, specific amendments to the City of Winnipeg Charter, the City of Winnipeg's legislation that exists at the province so that Winnipeg can that creates our charter. I haven't found that document yet, but it's probably here somewhere in Demas. Again, I'm just sort of searching here on the fly. I support the idea. We had started studying this area before. And but the integrity commission will be designated the original as be responsible for review and future changes of the lobbyist registry process, as well as for recommending changes to council on the city of Winnipeg charter in consultation with the city solicitor, as detailed. Okay, it is in this report here. So again, I think we've already gone down this road, Councillor Neeson. I don't think the province has obliged us to this point.
It has been 4 years. So that was part of the intent of looking at this.
All right, sounds good. So this will be referred to the governance committee then?
Well, EPC is the path.
Okay.
So you'll have another chance to dissect and comment. Any comments? Mr. Chair?
All right. Well, I'm fine to move the motion, or do you have a vote on the motion? Are we prepared for this time?
Yeah, call a question.
Sure. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Okay, great.
Councilor.
Yes, Councilor Roy.
I have one other item of new business. I'd like to move a $500 per capita grant for the Canadian Friends of Hockey in Ukraine.
Okay.
And I'll forward the clerk the particular information for that.
So you're moving 500 from your per capita?
Per capita, yes.
What if I put in 150 for that of your 500?
In this case, it is for a particular, it's a program they're running for a golf tournament. So I'm actually covered two registrations in terms of my support. So I don't think it's necessary, but.
No, that's great. Fair enough. The motion's been heard. Those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Motion carries.
I appreciate the gesture.
It's all good.
Mr. Chair, I have one further matter that I'd like to be able to deal with today, if we could. There was a community incentive grant application presented by a member of the community with regards to establishment of a flagpole in downtown, and I like to say that, downtown Transcona. It's being undertaken in partnership with the biz, with the museum, with the Legion, and 50% of the proceeds are being supported by a Transcona citizens group. So I'd like to move $2,561.67 from the Transcona allotment to support the establishment of the downtown Transcona flagpole project. That's my motion.
All right.
All right, Councilor Nason, what was the amount again? 2,000?
2,561.67. I'll forward you the application that was submitted to the CIGP email account on Friday the 23rd.
Pending approval. Pending approval.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just try to move things along because it's an important one that I've had multiple discussions on.
All right, those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Any further motions from my fellow councillors?
Yes, I have another one that I'm really quite excited about. Racquetball Manitoba has been seeking a location to set up a new outdoor facility, and they've been very aggressive in finding support from their national association and local funds. They're they've come forward with a project at our Quadrant Park, actually, up at Harborview Kukona Park. The total project is an $81,000 upgrade of one of the of an old racquetball facility amenities that are at that location, and very minimal city money actually going into it at the end of the day. Switch screens here. It's I had it. $25,000 from Racquetball Canada, $20,165 from the Racquetball Manitoba, $16,000 from the Manitoba Handball Association, and I'm proposing from my North Kildonan allocation a $10,000 CIGP grant. Early indications are is that it meets all criteria. So I just wanted to get this on the public record. There is designated ways of doing this, but I wanted to put it on the public record here today. So I have some advice from the clerk on how to do this. I move that funding in the amount of $10,000 from the East Kildonan Transcona Land Dedication Reserve, North Kildonan Ward Allocation, be recommended for approval to the Racquetball Manitoba project at Harborview Kukona Park to assist with the cost of the project, subject to the following conditions. One, submission of an application to Winnipeg Public Service. In the event an application has not been received between 2 years of the date of the subject meeting, the matter will not be proceeded with. Two, confirmation from Winnipeg Public Service that the application meets criteria, and three, approval of final plans and specifications for the project by the City of Winnipeg. That is my motion, Mr. Chair.
All right, $10,000. Would you include in your motion, if it's a friendly amendment, to include $10,000 from Elmwood East Kelowna?
Again, the project is actually at this point otherwise fully funded. If you wanted to split the project in half or even three ways, 333 each.
That's the challenge with not seeing the application. So
yeah, I appreciate that. That's fair. So I'll do the extra dollar. I'll go 3,334 and 3,333 from the rest sure. of you good folks. So that thank you so much. I do appreciate it. I shout out to Jennifer Saunders that I met up during the height of the pandemic last year for a very socially distanced tour of what was there already. And
is that the solid white wall?
Yes, part? It's going to be up.
I always thought that was a single person practice wall for tennis.
That's the racquetball piece. It's going to be radically upgraded.
I know the courts in the tennis courts in that facility, as just about everything in that facility, is woefully in need of reinvestment. And I know that there's a master plan to undertake all these. I am concerned that, you know, like if it's upgraded, will this be impacted in part of the revitalization plan of the regional park?
Again, it's already been, they've worked quite closely with Carl, the area technician, and this is, there's no plans of razzing or changing radically that particular section. That is going to continue to be handball sports, I suppose, if that's what they call them.
Okay. All right.
And I'm sending to both of you a copy of the information I received in the last 5 days.
All right, so motion is understood by the clerk. 30.
Right. You're taking the extra cent, right?
Dollar.
Dollar. Sorry, dollar. Okay, thanks.
Mason's a hard bargainer. Okay, great. We're dealing with the dollars and not the cents here. Okay, great. Motion's being heard. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Any further new motions? Seeing none, it's 10:15. Are we allowed to start the hearings before?
No, Chair. We'll can take a recess until 10:30.
Yep.
Great.
So moved.
Okay. All right. We'll take a recess till 10:30. Thank you. Good morning and welcome to the hearings portion of this regularly scheduled meeting of the Elmwood of the East Kelowna and Transcona Community Committee this Wednesday, April 28th, 2021. I'm Jason Schreier, the City Councilor for the Elmwood East Kelowna Ward and this year's Chair of the Community Committee. We also have with us Sean Nason, City Councilor for the Transcona Ward, as well as Jeff Brawadi, City Councilor for the North Kelowna Ward. We are on Treaty 1 territory and the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. And now with our hearings, Clerk Pomanski, would you introduce the first hearing item?
Sure. Thank you, Chair. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you are not obligated to do so. For a more in-depth overview of the public hearing process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing, please consult the public hearing process brochure, which is available on the City Clerk's Department website. Please note all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the hearings have concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item one is a subdivision and rezoning at 436 Martin Avenue West under file DASZ 3 of 2021. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing and the following items will also be heard at the same time. Namely, item two is a variance at 436 Martin Avenue West under file DAV 232818 of 2020D. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support, those registered in opposition, and then those registered for info. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made, however, no new information is permitted. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you have been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. Now turn it over to our planner Femi to give an overview.
You all. On that DASZ 3 2021 and DAB 20232818, The applicant intends to subdivide the existing parcel into two lots, rezone the property from R1S, which is a single family residential small, to R2, residential two family district. The intent is to construct a single building or side by side to facilitate a duplex on that particular site. There are two variances being requested at this time, and the urban plan division is supportive of those variances. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Ojo. Do we have questions for the administration? Councilor Nason?
I'm just wondering if the administration can provide any update pertaining to our last meeting and CSO related matters.
Yeah, sorry, I believe that's for water and waste.
Sure, Mr. Shanks.
Yeah, in terms of this particular application, like as you know, it's in a combined sewer district, and the way the sewer system is designed here, it's designed to protect people's basements by overflowing into the river when there's peak flow events. So any additional flow into the system, increases the likelihood of an overflow. So it falls under the development in these districts fall under our clauses of our license, and we're currently in the process of proposing a method to accommodate these smaller developments, like the development of a vacant lot, like in this scenario. We proposed to the province a way to accommodate those increases in flows by basically crediting reductions elsewhere in the system with our larger CSO projects. Unfortunately, that we haven't got final approval from the province on that, but we anticipate we will get approval on it. So for this specific application, under the authority of the director, we're gonna approve it, and accommodate. Our intent is to accommodate that increase in flows elsewhere in the system with a credit. And like I said, we're anticipating this approach is going to be approved by the province. So, this is a one-off. It's the circumstances of the timing that we're waiting for. We're still waiting for approval, but we're close to it. And that this is Habitat for Humanity, like the nature of the applicant and the purpose of the development is one of the factors. So in this case, we've proposed a new new clause, like the removal of those clauses in the approval. Not sure if Merrick, if you want to add any more details to that. I think that's basically the high level overview.
Yeah, I'll go ahead. From the ACG report, there are several clauses that we're proposing to remove at this point, so I'll go through those. Section one, general comments, all three clauses, one, two, and three. Section two, engineering studies, clause one, so that full section. Section three, servicing conditions, lot line servicing is the first part of that, so removing 1A.
Thank you. Councilor Schreier?
Yeah, I'm just reading the recommendation and just trying to relate that to what we just heard. All right, I've got no further questions at this time. It's really up to Sandy Hopkins in my mind. Having said that, I'll open to any other further questions or comments from my fellow councillors.
None.
Okay. Nonetheless, thanks to both of you for your participation last meeting, helping my community specifically. Thank you, and or the one for which I'm responsible. And all right, I have no further questions for the administration.
No I'll move to the applicant. We have Sandy Hopkins. Okay. Hi, Sandy.
There we go.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Good morning, Sandy. Does Sandy need to say his name and address, given that we're still in the delegation from we're still in the same hearing from the last meeting?
Sure. Yeah, up to him.
Sandy Hopkins, S-A-N-D-Y, H-O-P-K-I-N-S, Chief Executive Officer, Habitat for Humanity, Manitoba.
Thank you, Mr. Hopkins, and you have 10 minutes.
All right. Well, it sounds as if the issue has been resolved, and we're hopeful then that the committee will agree with the recommendation and approve our application.
Okay. That's what I wanted to hear. So this is great.
We're ready to go.
Okay. Wonderful. Any further comments or any questions?
We had our engineer look at it, and he talked to the city as well. And there is no capacity issue. It was just the matter of this issue with the province, and they understood that it was going to be satisfactorily resolved as well. So it's good to hear that that's the case.
Okay. Thank you very much. Good luck. Well, we'll see. We'll see. I'm not going to premeditate the next 30 seconds, but we'll see how it goes. Any further questions or comments for Mr. Hopkins?
No.
Okay, thank you. All right, Clerk Pomanski, where do we go from here?
So we don't have anyone else registered in support or opposition or for information. So if you have any other questions for the public service at this point.
No, we didn't. Thank you to my fellow councillors. We had a good a meeting as well with the administration to help clarify this. And look like we've come to a good resolution. I've got no further questions or comments. I'm ready to move a motion, if I may.
You want me to take the chair?
Yes, please.
Okay. Go ahead, then.
Thank you. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
I move that...
Go ahead.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried.
I move that the recommendations of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Executive Policy Committee via the priority rezoning process.
We're going to take those amendments. You would be forwarded to the Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development.
Okay, so said Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development, Heritage and Downtown Development.
Okay. Restating the amendments.
The amendment as understood by the clerk.
Reiterate, I was received waterways. So in the ACG report, looking to delete section 1, general comments, yes. Delete section 2, engineering studies, and in section 3, delete 1A with the rest remaining. Yeah. Correct, Merrick?
Yes, that's correct. Sorry for the
delay. So it's been heard. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that the following supporting reasons be provided. Oh, and this one I may defer to Councillor Nason for all his insight in the previous meeting. I've been through a number of these developments with Habitat. And just given this one, look, we've been through a lot on this one. And I'm just glad to see that we've come to... a proper agreement amongst all parties on this, and then we can move forward for this development with Habitat for Humanity for me to have some new good neighbors. And I'll leave my comments at that.
Okay. Council Perotti, no comments. Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried.
And that
please
is that.
Note that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter that will now proceed to council. No further representations are permitted on the subdivision rezoning. All persons registered for the public hearing will receive notice when the matter is to be considered by council. And now we move to the variance.
Okay. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I move that receipt of public representations be concluded.
All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 247(3) of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. Does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. Is the minimum modification by zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated? And I have no further comments at this time.
Okay. No further or same comments as before?
Yes, same comments, no further comments. Thank you, Councilor.
All right. Okay. Comments have been heard or questions been heard. All in favor? Aye. Opposed? Carried.
I move that I recommend that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variance be approved.
All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Carried.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, I mean, information on how to do so will be included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Okay, Chair, back to you, sir.
Thank you, Councillor Nason. Thank you, Clerk Promansky. All right, so we're now at hearing item number 3.
Perhaps do you want to take a 5-minute recess, just the applicant isn't in the waiting room yet. We can let everyone in, is that okay?
That's fine. So we'll come back at 10:55.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, great. All right. Welcome back to today's community committee of East Kelowna Transcona. And where are we at this point, Clerk Promansky?
I'll just introduce the item, Chair. Thank you. Item 3 is a subdivision and rezoning at 228 and 230 Grassy Boulevard under file DASZ 31 of 2020. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing, and the following items will also be heard at the same time. Namely, item 4 is a variance at 228 and 230 Grassy Boulevard under file DAV 227429 of 2020D. Item 5 is a demolition at 228 and 230 Grassy Boulevard under file 227094 of 2020. The process the committee will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, those registered in opposition, and those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. All participants have been muted and will only be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you have been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch live via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute your audio player now. I'll now turn it over to our planner, Femi, to give an overview.
Good morning, councillors. Under DASZ 31, 2020, the applicant intends to consolidate existing lots, lots 228 and 230 Grassy Boulevard. These two lots are currently zoned R1L, which is a residential single family large district, and rezone the two lots when it's been combined to RMFM zoning district, which is a residential multifamily district. The intent of the applicant is to construct a three-story 24 unit residential development. And with these 24 units, he's proposing 33 parking stalls. Vehicular access will be through Grassy Boulevard. And there also with this application, there are two variances. One is the variance application for yard setback, for parking, for insufficient landscaping, and the accessory parking area. There is also a demo or application, which is also a variance application, because this is triggered because the applicant does not really have approved plan of development at this time. The Urban Plan Division is supportive of both the DAZ, the variance applications, and the demo at this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ojo. Where are we at, Clerk Promansky?
You're from the applicant, John Winthrop.
Good morning, John.
Good morning. John Winchup, I'm the applicant. My understanding this matter was adjourned from the last public hearing to allow a resident who attended the last hearing to provide information on the public record regarding another property, not related to this one, but up the street from us. So I'm assuming that will take place. But since that adjournment, I've been engaging with local residents or continuing to engage with them. I provided you some documentation via the clerk last night, new information that I hope this tribunal will consider. I submitted it digitally to the clerk yesterday. I had previously provided it to the resident, Matthew, who I believe will be speaking later. We've used the time, as I mentioned, to discuss with the residents to hear some concerns, and we're willing to, you know, seek a compromise and make revisions to the site plan. I've got that package currently as it exists right now. We're still, as I indicated, engaging with the resident. But one of the items I did submit had to do about lot grading, which came up at the last public hearing and has continually come up in discussions with the residents. And I've provided the committee with information about how the lot grading process works here in Winnipeg and the lot grading bylaw. I know you've heard this information many times before from the public service and from other applicants. But I think just to put it onto the public record, I've given you a document, and very briefly, there is a lot grading bylaw that all land that is developed in Winnipeg has to adhere to. The Water and Waste Department will police it. An engineer will have to draw up a plan to contour and shape the land to ensure drainage for this property and other properties are not negatively impacted. My best guess is the lands will drain into the Grassy Boulevard drainage system, not onto adjacent lands. That'll have to be designed by an engineer. That's usually done at the building permit stage, not at this stage. Water and Waste will inspect this, review the plan, seal it. It'll go out and get constructed. Water and Waste will inspect it. If there's any issues, residents actually can call the Water and Waste Department, and they'll send inspectors out to look at the property. So right now, any questions or commitments related to what can we do for lot grading, I can just reassure you my client and the developer will adhere to the City of Winnipeg bylaws and municipal regulations regarding lot drainage, and the engineers will look after this property as well as the adjacent properties. There's an entire process in place that has been there for decades to ensure that. I know councillors from Transcona particularly have had to deal with that in the Transcona West area, a little bit in the North Kadonan area, and these new areas where you might have some low-laying land, et cetera, and other residents, but there is an entire process in place there to address that at the building permit stage. Some of the other concerns we had from the residents that we've taken into account that I've put into a site plan is to relocate garbage enclosures, increase fencing, landscaping, buffering, and those are items that we're prepared to do here. One of the residents, I believe, has requested that this be adjourned to allow us to the May meeting, to allow us to continue engaging. I believe they've requested that I do interact with them on a Zoom webinar to go over the site plan that we've generated and I provided to you yesterday. I'm more than happy and willing to do that if the committee is willing to entertain that adjournment. I believe there's been some positive dialogue and engagement going back and forth. And if there's a consensus and a willingness for people to work on both sides to come up with a project that will fit into the neighborhood and the community, I'm more than supportive of that kind of notion. I can go over the details of the site plan, but if we're looking to adjourn it, that could evolve more, as again, we're willing to make changes to the site plan to address concerns from the residents. For example, one item is we've increased the east side yard. I believe it's now around 10 to 12 feet to ensure more buffering against the eastern neighbor. That's just one element of the change we've made to the site plan. I will turn it back to the tribunal this time unless they have any questions. I believe I've laid out a bit of a process here that we're willing to engage with moving to advance this to move forward.
Thank you, Mr. Winthrop. Thank you for that explanation. This is on board. I'll just say at this point, pleased with your explanations at this point. And yes, there's no point in showing any further plans. As you say, it may very well evolve given further discussions as you engage with the neighbors. And on that basis, I've got no further questions for you at this time. I guess may very well in May. Any further questions or comments for John Wintrup? Councilor Rawati.
Just a quick question. If the site plan changes, would the variances need changing as well? Is there any concern that you need to submit something different?
I if there is a need for different variances, we're prepared to do that. As you know, in many projects like this, you'll see even 2 to 4 years later, somebody coming back in on a multifamily dwelling to get different variances or new set. The process we're going through today is variances related to a site plan that we just need to provide as part of a rezoning and a subdivision application. You'll require a conditional that is site plan approval. And at that time, there'll be a more detailed analysis of what exactly we're going to construct, and there might trigger new variances. So quite often, and it's typical to see a project, usually multiple family, for a applicant to return within 2 to 4 years with a different set of variances. We're committed to, if we need different variances or a different set of variances, to, if that is a variance that is triggered because we're trying to resolve an issue with a resident, we're committed to that process to do that.
Good.
Thank you. All right. Thank you, Mr. Wintrup. I think that's it.
So, Mr. Chair, would you wish for me to move an adjournment to the May meeting?
Yes, please. Can we move a motion at this time, Clerk Polanski?
Just a quick moment. Planner Ojo wishes to speak.
Do you want to ask the applicant if the May meeting is feasible for him to kind of put the process together in terms of engaging the public and putting out new variances?
I think he suggested in his last comments that in terms of a variance, that would, you know, if the variance is no longer relevant, that could be dealt with at a later point.
Okay,
I think is what the applicant was stating. He's nodding.
Yes, I agree. It's like I said, it's typical for variances to come in 2 to 4 years after a subdivision rezoning is approved. I'd like to be able to report back to the May meeting, ideally with hand in hand with the residents, that this thing is being resolved. But it won't end any, to reassure the residents, it doesn't end then. There will still be more public and process to go through, as there is still potential variances that we have to get into when we get into more of a building permit stage. But there's also a site plan approval that has to go through. So the engagement will be ongoing, but the public approval process will be ongoing. But I certainly would like to come back to the May meeting and be able to either update or report back to the committee of the progress that we're making on this matter.
John, you're probably aware of the rules in that if it is laid over to the May meeting, that would be the last opportunity. Judgment would have to be made at that time. Or Clerk Polanski, if it was, sorry?
Or withdraw?
Clerk Polanski, in terms of the, you know, maximum 3-meeting limit, if the applicant is amenable at that 3rd meeting to lay it over an additional meeting, is at that point, can it be held over another meeting?
Correct. At the request of the applicant, according to the Development Procedures Bylaw 15 sub 2, the restrictions at the request of the applicant, it can be, a public hearing can be adjourned for longer than the 3 meetings.
Okay. So, okay. Just want some clarification.
But John, it would have to be at the request of you. The committee cannot request to adjourn this hearing past the May 26th, 2021 meeting.
Yes, I understand that. Yes. And
you were probably the planner at the time that rule came in.
I understand all the regulations that are in place now and that will be in place in the future. And I will appreciate that if I feel there's movement, and I hope there is. And ideally, I'd like to come forward at the May meeting hand in hand with the residents saying we can advance this together and that we've addressed many of their concerns. That for me, as I think, an ideal outcome for all parties concerned. And if there needs to be a further adjournment while there's still movement or progress being made, I'll make that request if it's needed.
Very good.
Okay, Councilor Mason?
Yeah, just, it seems that we're really now sort of rushing this if there are changes. It's one of those things, like June sounds more at peace as opposed to rushed. I just don't know why the applicant's not looking to hold till the June meeting. That way everybody has the opportunity to breathe and not be rushed at this matter.
Any comments about that, John?
Well, I think I'd like to, like I said, if have to come back and I'd like to report progress. I like to keep this item moving. And for us, we've started this process quite some time ago, and I like to see it wrap up in a timely manner and not drag on. So ideally, I think that I feel the May meeting, if I can come back and if it's to report back and say either we have an agreement with the residents or we are still progressing and we need time, then I'll certainly make that request from the May to the June meeting to say we still need some time here to address items. My concern about laying it over until June is then this drops off on everybody's radar and suddenly I'm scrambling around in June because everyone thought they had room to breathe on this.
Chair, I think our planner needs to comment.
I just want to make a comment that if new variances are required, then the site will need to be posted and then it takes all of the variance process again, which might I'm just looking at the fact that the May meeting may not be visible if new variants are required, that requires site being posted. And
Tammy, he's said twice now that he's not worried about the variances right now. The variances aren't needed.
Okay.
Sorry, I was muted. Councilor Rowe, you're saying that
I have the motion on the floor to lay it over to the May meeting, but
sure. Any further comments? Seeing none, those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. All right.
Just to confirm, this item is going to be heard. We're keeping public hearing representations open, and this item will be heard on May 26, 2021 at 10:30 a.m., 510 Main Street in the chamber.
Thank you, Clark.
Thank you.
I'll move adjournment.
All right. Those in favor?
Aye.
Motion, we've got adjournment. Thank you very much, everybody. See you soon.